Our God can make beautiful things out of dust. And that's why I can say to you today, no matter what you've gone through in the past, no matter what challenges are facing you right now, I can say to you, Happy Sunday! Well, it is so great to see all of you here this morning. How many of you are excited to be in church this morning? All right, I love it. I love the woo-hoo, too. I love that. It makes me feel so good. And of course, I'm excited to be here. How could I not be excited when I get to spend time with wonderful people like you? So thanks so much, everybody, for coming out, for being a part of things today. I'm doing my best these days. I'm working my hardest these days to give you 2020 vision for 2020. And why am I doing that? Because I want you to see yourself clearly. I want you to see yourself accurately. I want you to see yourself the way God sees you. Because let me tell you something, and you listen up good. You may be doing okay right now in life, but it's time for you to move up to the next level. It's time for you to move up to the next level. See, we all have these things in our life that hold us back. You know, maybe we're carrying around a load of guilt from past mistakes. Maybe you experience temptation, and it seems like you just can't overcome that temptation. Maybe it's a dysfunction that was passed on to you. And it's easy to learn to accept that situation and that condition and just think, well, that's just who we are. That's the way my life goes. But God didn't create you to go through life weighed down by addiction. God didn't create you to go through life weighed down by dysfunction. God did not create you to go through life weighed down by guilt. He created you to be free. When Jesus hung upon the cross, right before he died, as he drew in his last breath, he shouted in a great big voice, "It is finished." Now, Jesus was not talking just about his own life being finished or his own destiny being finished. He was saying to us, I'm putting an end to all that stuff, to all that stuff that's trying to hold you back. The guilt is finished. The low self-esteem is finished. The mediocrity is finished. It is all finished. Here's what I'm saying. Maybe you wrestle with addiction, for example. Lots of people do. Lots of people in our church. But instead of accepting that addiction and thinking, well, this is the way it's always going to be for me. It's just always going to be a struggle. And everybody in my family has the same battle. No, instead, you need to announce to that addiction, it is finished. You can't control me. You can't hold me down. The price has been paid. I am clean. I am whole. I am strong. Now think of it yourself. Are there things that you're living with right now, things you're going through in your life right now, to which you need to say, it is finished? Maybe, I don't know, maybe you're going around feeling down on yourself, feeling guilty because of past mistakes. You need to say, it is finished. I am done beating myself up. God's mercy is bigger than my mistakes. I am redeemed. I am restored. Maybe you're living with a sense of shame, feeling inferior because of the way somebody has been treating you. You need to say, it is finished. I'm not inferior to anybody. I am the child of the Most High God, and it is royal blood that is flowing through my veins. Maybe you're living with a ton of self-pity. You're always making excuses for your lot in life. You say, well, Jeff, it's not my fault. Nobody comes through for me. Everybody lets me down. No, you need to say, it is finished. My problems may be big, but my God is bigger. I'm asking you to get rid of all excuses. Because as long as you keep making excuses, as long as you keep justifying your condition, you're giving yourself permission to stay the same, to stay stuck just the way you are. I'm telling you, it's time to move up, but it's up to you. Do you want to get better? That's the question. Do you want to get better? You know, there's a story in the Bible in John chapter 5 where Jesus meets someone. And the person he meets is a disabled man who's basically been homeless for the past 38 years. When Jesus sees the man lying there on the street, he asks him a question. And it's kind of an odd question, I think. He says, "Do you want to get better?" Now, I think that's an odd question because you'd think the answer would be obvious. Of course he wants to get better. But the funny thing is Jesus can take one look at that man and say, "I don't see anything in this man's actions or this man's attitude to indicate that he actually wants to change. There's nothing in him that says, I'm expecting things to get better." I kind of picture that man lying there, just lying there on the sidewalk. And he's got his bed set up, you know, just the way he likes it. And I can imagine he's got the whole area around him arranged. You know, it's like, here's his little table. And on that, he's got a little lamp. He's got a few books arranged and favorite magazines and maybe a family picture there. And see, over the course of 38 years living out there on the street, he's gotten comfortable in his dysfunction. He's like, well, this is just my lot in life. It's never going to be any better. And he has surrounded himself with other people who are sick, with other people who are homeless, with other people who are afflicted. He gravitates naturally to people who are just like him. Everyone around him is down. Everyone is discouraged. Everyone is complaining. And let me remind you of something. Let me just remind you of something. You need to be very careful about who you surround yourself with, especially in difficult times. Very careful who you bring around you in life. He has surrounded himself with other people who are just like him. So when Jesus comes along and says, "Do you want to get better?" The man doesn't say, "You betcha." He just starts making excuses. And I'll tell you, as long as you're making excuses for where you are, you're going to be stuck. You say, "Oh, Jeff, I'm this way because, you know, I had a really rough childhood." Or, "I'm bitter because my business partner cheated me." Or, "I'm negative because I live with this physical condition every single day." Well, I'm asking you to get rid of the excuses. You may not understand it all. It may not be fair. But listen, if you take the hand that God has dealt to you, that life has dealt to you, and you make the most of it, God will get you where you're supposed to be. God, no person, no bad break, no addiction, no sickness can stop you. God has the last word when it comes to your life. So tell that self-pity, it is finished. Tell all those excuses, it is finished. No matter how big your problem is, your God is bigger. So Jesus looks right straight in the eyes of the disabled man. Looks him straight in the eye. And he says, "Get up, pick up your bed and walk." And instantly that man got up and he walked away, probably skipped away from there. And maybe God has decided he's going to do something like that for you. What you think is permanent, what looks like it can never change in your life, that addiction that you've had for years, that illness, that situation with your finances, you don't see a way for that to change. But God has a way. And another thing I want you to remember, where you come from is not who you are. Sometimes you need to say that to yourself. Where you come from is not who you are. I know a man who these days is very successful. He was raised in a typical middle-class background. His dad was a cop. His mom was a nurse. When he was 11 years old, one day his dad said, "Get in the car. We're going for a ride." He said, "Where are we going?" His dad said, "You'll find out." They drove and they drove for hours. His dad wouldn't tell them where they were headed. They crossed over the state line and kept driving. Finally, they came to this run-down old neighborhood with trash lying around everywhere. None of the buildings kept up. The boy's eyes were wide. He had never seen anything like this. They pulled into a dirt driveway and pulled up to a house that was completely fallen apart. There was no front door. The windows were broken out. It looked like it was abandoned. He followed his dad into that house, and he was shocked to find an old man in the front room sitting on a stool. That man was shirtless. He hadn't shaved, and it looked like he was homeless. His dad looked at that old man and he said these words. He said, "Dad, I brought my son to meet you." The boy couldn't believe that this could be his grandfather. He had never, ever seen a picture of his grandfather. His own father had never talked about his grandfather before. Well, that grandfather wouldn't even look up. He didn't want anything to do with his son or his grandson. So the dad took out some money and put it on the counter. He said, "Dad, I love you. I just came by to say hi." And then he turned around, and the two of them walked out of the shack. The boy said, "Dad, that was the most uncomfortable. That was like the most afraid I have ever been in my entire life." His father looked at him and said, "Son, that's why I brought you here, to show you that this is where we come from, but this is not who we are." Some of you need to look at your own life and you just say, "You know what? This is where I come from, but this is not who I am." You may have been raised in a very limited environment. Maybe you came from a very dysfunctional home. Maybe your family members were good people, but they just had no vision for a better life, and so they settled with mediocrity. But like that boy and his dad, you can be the one to set a new standard. Where you start is not important. Where you finish is what matters. Where you come from is not who you are. Who are you in reality? You are blessed. You are gifted. You are talented. The favor and blessing of Almighty God rests upon you. You are a person who's being guided by God Himself. You are the sons and the daughters of the Most High God. That's who you are. In the Bible, this is exactly what happened to David. Same David who fought Goliath. His family didn't see him as a giant killer or as a future king. In fact, the Bible says one time the prophet Samuel came to visit their family. And Samuel said to David's father, Jesse, he said, "Jesse, I'm going to choose one of your sons to be the next king of Israel. So bring them all in here and line them up, and I'm going to choose the one and anoint him to be king." Well, Jesse calls all of his sons in there except for David. He's thinking, you know what, it couldn't be David. David's not king material. He's saying, "David, he's so small, he's so young, he's so inexperienced. David's not good for anything but watching over a bunch of smelly sheep." Well, guess what? God thought David was the one. People don't determine your destiny. What they say about you, how they make you feel about yourself, cannot stop what God has ordained for your life. And my friend, with all due respect, you need to distance yourself from people who are always trying to put limitations on you, who are always trying to hold you back, who are trying to keep you from what God has placed in your heart. And sometimes, listen, sometimes that includes the people who have known you the longest because they only see you one way. That's exactly what happened to Jesus. You're just like Jesus. Did you ever realize that? In fact, the Bible tells us Jesus' own brothers did not rightly respect him. Jesus' own brothers did not believe in him until he rose from the dead. He was performing miracle after miracle, but they didn't see him as the Messiah. They only saw him as their brother. And they thought, "Oh, him? That's just Jesus. We grew up with him. He's nothing special." In fact, at the height of his popularity, the Bible tells us that his brothers scoffed at him and made fun of him. They said, "Yeah, right, you're the Messiah. We're not going to believe that." They tried to discount him and talk him out of his destiny. Jesus let it go in one ear and out the other. Well, maybe you're not exactly Jesus, but you can follow his lead. You may have been raised in a very limited environment. You may not have had a lot of advantages growing up or a lot of family support, but where you come from is not who you are. Where you start is not important. Where you finish is what matters. So get ready. Friends, get ready. It's easy to talk yourselves out of dreams and live discouraged because all those disappointments you've had and all the things that have happened to you that you don't understand. Like, you know, you worked hard and you didn't get the promotion. You prayed and your loved one didn't pull through. You did your best and that relationship just didn't work out. See, life isn't always fair. And I can't begin to explain why all the things happen to you the way they do. But I can tell you this much. What other people meant for your harm, God can turn around and use to your advantage. He says in the Bible that he will pay you back double. He will pay you back double for all those unfair things that have happened to you. He says he will give you beauty for ashes. But here's the key. You got to let go of the ashes before he can give you the beauty. You can't hold on to the old and expect to receive the new. The past is over and done. That's why we call it past. Quit dwelling on it. Quit reliving it. You're not going to understand everything that happened to you, but God has a purpose for it. He knows how to bring good out of it. So keep moving forward day by day. You know, that's what David did. He had a newborn baby who was very sick when it was born. And night and day, David prayed for that little baby. He wouldn't eat. He wouldn't talk to anyone. He spent all of his time, every hour, on his knees, pleading with God to spare the life of his child. But on the seventh day, the baby died. David's men didn't know how to tell him. They didn't think he could handle the news. They thought it would break him. But when they told him, David got up, washed his face, changed his clothes, and went to the temple to worship God. And when he finished, he went and had dinner with some of his friends. They were so amazed, they asked him, David, how can you be acting this way? When the child was still alive, you wept and refused to eat. But now that he's dead and gone, you've stopped your mourning and you're acting like everything is okay. David looked at them and he said, you know, while the child was alive, I pleaded with God to let him live. But now, I didn't get my way. I can't bring him back. I can't bring him back. But one day I will go to be with him. David did everything he could. He prayed and he fasted and he believed with all his heart. But it didn't work out his way. He could have lived bitter with a chip on his shoulder. But David understood this principle. He said to the past, it is finished. I don't understand it, but I'm moving forward. And we all have things like that. Things that happen in our life that we don't understand. And it's easy to live life negatively with a chip on our shoulder. But if we're going to receive double, if we're going to see beauty for ashes, we have to do like David. We have to say to the past, we have to say to all those things we don't understand, it is finished. I'm not going to dwell on what didn't work in my life. I'm not going to try to figure it all out. I'm going to let it go. I'm going to let it go and keep moving forward to the next level day by day. You see, the past doesn't have to stop you. That bad break, that loss, that disappointment, God is in control of your life. You wouldn't be alive today unless he had something spectacular in store for you. So get ready. I'm telling you, get ready. You do your part and put on a new attitude. Get up, wash your face, and get ready for the new things that God is going to do for you. Because let me tell you what I see when I look at you. The past, the hurts, the regrets, it is finished. The poverty, the lack, the excuses, it is finished. The addictions, the depression, the dysfunction, it is finished. The guilt, the shame, the self-pity, it is finished. You're about to see beauty for ashes. You're about to see and experience something new. You're about to move up to the next level. And because of that, I'm going to invite you right now just to bow your heads and let's say a prayer together. As we get ready to pray, let me ask you a question. What situation do you think is always holding you back? Think about that. Think about that question. What situation, what aspect of your life has been holding you back and bringing you down? Next question, do you want to get better? Do you want to get better? What excuses do you use to justify the lack of progress in your life? We bring all that to God right now, every bit of it. We pray together, dear God, you are in control of my life. I know the past doesn't have to stop me. I know you've got good things waiting in my future. That bad break, that loss, that disappointment, I know that you, God, are bigger than my biggest problem. Your mercy is bigger than my biggest mistakes. And so I'm going to put on a new attitude. I'm going to do my part, God, and I will trust that you do your part. I'm going to do my best to make the most of the hand that's been dealt to me. But I know in faith that you will get me where I need to be in life. And most of all, I open my life to your son, Jesus. You know, I'm honestly still getting to know him and understand him. I'm still learning to love him. But I believe that he is what he claimed to be, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. So Jesus, please be my Savior and be my best friend. Amen.